Good evening and welcome to Georgetown University, and thank you all for joining us for this conversation on faith, feminism, and being unfinished, the question of women's ordination. We are tonight 500 people gathered here on April 17th, 2023, in person in Copley Formal Lounge and online from across the country, including Hawaii, and from six continents around the globe. Yeah. Incredible. I think there's some interest in this conversation. My name is Jane Varner Malhotra. I am a graduate of Dartmouth College and Georgetown University. I am the Director of Advancement Communications here, and I am one of the organizers of the event. I am also, especially tonight, the niece of Anne E. Patrick. She was a Sister of the Holy Names, a professor, author, and moral theologian whose writings inspire these unfinished gatherings. Anne, as a native Washingtonian, born at the old Georgetown Hospital just around the corner, would be pleased that we gather on this important day in local and global liberation history and remember DC Emancipation Day, which was yesterday but is being celebrated today. On April 16th, 1862, 3,100 individuals who were enslaved here in Washington were freed through the DC Compensated Emancipation Act, planting the seeds for the Emancipation Proclamation declared 8 months later, officially ending slavery nationwide. We thank Native Washingtonian and historian, the late Loretta Carter Haynes, for her lifelong advocacy for recognition of this important day in our community and well beyond. The timing of tonight's conversation coincides with the Vatican's three-year synod. This word is new to a lot of us. It's a global listening project to understand how the Spirit is moving among the people of the church. The question of women's ordination has been raised again and again around the world as part of this process, and Georgetown is pleased to host tonight's dialogue on this important topic with these five panelists. As the oldest Catholic university in the country, and as a Jesuit institution committed to the greater good, including gender justice, Georgetown is convening this conversation because it matters. Anne Patrick published her essay, A Conservative Case for the Ordination of Women, in 1975, the International Year of the Woman, nearly 50 years ago. I was in grade school in Indiana at the time and hoped to become an altar server, even though the role was limited to boys. I asked my teacher why and was told that the bishop made this rule. So I wrote to him. Months later, Bishop McManus wrote back, explaining that unfortunately the cardinals in Rome make the rule. I was disappointed, but eventually I lost interest. In recent years, this desire has begun to simmer again in me as I discern a call to priesthood. To me and to many of us in the church, the question of women's ordination is, yes, institutional, but also deeply personal and sometimes painful. But it's also an experience of joy and creativity, because with God, all things are wildly possible. In this spirit of joy and creativity, we are grateful to artist Sister Celeste Mokrzycki. She's a Sister of St. Joseph's from Philadelphia. She is chaplain of Georgetown School of Health and School of Nursing, and she will be interpreting the spirit of the event tonight through painting. We honor and recognize all those who are bringing this event together and who are staying late to put things back in order. Thank you to our custodians, our events staff, the catering crew, the volunteers, all who helped with publicity, and there were a lot of us, registration, event management, and our audiovisual friends who are live streaming the program and recording and archiving it for posterity. And now we invite all to join in this historic dialogue of hope, creativity, and transformation as we continue the important work for the world. And now Chaplain Joe Cecilio will offer our opening prayer.
Lord, we give you thanks for this day and the opportunity to grow in knowledge of ourselves, of each other, and of you. May today's discussion bring us closer to you, Lord. Tonight, we ask that you reveal to us more of who you are and more of who you call us to be. And though we are unfinished, you continue to weave a tapestry that includes the threads of all your people. May we be healers, lovers, and advocates for a more just world. Bless our panelists, our moderator, our artist, and all those present here and tuning in from afar. May we remember how blessed we are to be among women. In thanksgiving for all the powerful feminists who came before us, we all say, Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain Joe. And now I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Annie Selak, our moderator for tonight. Annie is the Associate Director of the Georgetown Women's Center. She is a Catholic theologian and minister, and she is currently writing The Wounded Church, a book with Fordham University Press that examines racism, sexism, and clericalism in the church. She teaches feminist theology on campus and has 15 years' experience in Catholic education, especially surrounding gender equity. Annie will lead us through the program tonight. Thank you, Annie.
Thank you. Well, it's an absolute pleasure to be here with you all tonight and to be the one to guide our conversation with our wonderful panelists. So our panelists tonight, we have five different panelists who are looking at this topic of women's ordination in the Catholic Church, as well as more broadly, women's roles in ministry, which also evokes questions of what is the church, who is the church, and who might we be called to be. So our panelists tonight are Teresa Delgado, Lynn Henke, Alice McDermott, Angel White, and Mary Hunt. As we proceed, I'll introduce each panelist, and then they will speak and offer their reflections, and we'll go down the line. And then after that, I'll moderate a bit of a conversation between the panelists. And after that, then we'll open it up for both those of you who are present here. We'll do a Q&A session. And those of you who are joining online, you can use the Q&A feature to submit your questions, and then they'll come to us here as well. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our first panelist, Teresa Delgado. Teresa is Dean of the St. John's College of Liberal Arts and Sciences at St. John's University. Previously, she served as director of the Peace and Justice Studies Program and professor and chairperson of the Religious Studies Department at Iona College. She received her doctorate from Union Theological Seminary in New York City under the guidance of the trailblazing womanist theologian, Dr. Dolores S. Williams. As an undergraduate, she studied philosophy and religion and women's studies at Colgate University. Welcome, Teresa.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here with all of you in the Georgetown community. I'm very grateful to be a part of this panel, so thank you, Annie and Jane, for the invitation. I want to just share that we too at St. John's are recently experienced the passing of one of our students, very tragically, and so along with her younger brother in a tragic fire. So we are grieving in solidarity with you here in the Georgetown community. When I began studying theology and religion as an undergraduate student at Colgate University, I had no idea that there were Catholics who supported the ordination of women. I had attended Catholic school through 12th grade, and the prospect of women in the priesthood was, for me, the stuff of fantasy. Until a whole new world was opened to me upon reading the works of Ann Patrick, Elizabeth Schussler Fiorenza, Rosemary Radford Ruther, Mary Hunt, among many others, whose advocacy on behalf of women forced me to reconsider an experience that I had when I was a child. A precocious little girl, I began reciting parts of the Missalette and forcing my sisters, my two sisters, to play church while I officiated as the priest. Ritz crackers and apple juice stood in for the bread and wine. And this was a common weekly occurrence until my father told me that I shouldn't pretend to be a priest because I would never have that chance in real life. I don't remember the exact words that he used, but I remember my reaction, which was to run away for a few hours until my mother retrieved me from the steps of a corner bodega with my eyes bloodshot and tears. So fast forward to the years following college graduation, even a three-year foray into banking couldn't keep me from a desire to explore my role in the church. So through the years of my doctoral study, I studied alongside colleagues who'd go on to be ordained in their respective denominations, and they encouraged me to consider the Episcopal and Lutheran churches to actualize my priestly vocational call. I didn't go that route because the question grew much larger than my fulfillment of a personal vocational call. Was I willing to forfeit the ability to challenge the Catholic Church, not just on its stance regarding ordination, but also the many ways it perpetuates white supremacy? I decided to stay, always on the margins, to push the church to see the connection between its stance on women's ordination and its dependence on colonizing epistemologies. Just 2 weeks ago, the Vatican issued a statement repudiating the doctrine of discovery, which has been used for the past 500 years as a religious and legal rationale to seize lands, objectify entire peoples, and impose a structure of white supremacist authority. I think we must look at the structure of the Catholic Church, including its exclusionary male leadership structure, in tandem with the manner in which it has structured its relationship with peoples and lands as a colonizing entity that must be decolonized. For this reason, I'm less interested now than I was in graduate school with women's ordination as a singular question. Rather, I wish to spend my time exploring the connection between sexual and institutional violence against women and the colonization of lands and people, as I believe both derive from an unequal power structure of subject over object and upheld by a hierarchy that maintains the status quo. So what are the alternatives to maintaining the status quo of colonization in our church? I believe the fact that the institutional church is beginning to show some crumbling through the clergy sex abuse crisis, yet another manifestation of dominant power, and diminishing credibility is a sign that the powerful hold of colonization is wearing thin and being recognized as a distortion of the gospel that it is. While promoting women in ordination is important, I'm not dismissing that, the process of decolonization of our church requires more than having women in leadership and at the altar. The corrective to colonization of women's bodies in the church requires that we learn from women's ways of being church. And I have learned those ways from women in my own community, from Latinas, from Latin American women, and from Black women in particular. This decolonization has at least five components, and I'll just list them briefly. One, centering and accompaniment and solidarity. Second, being focused less on the doctrinal and more on popular religiosity. Third, investing in communities and not in the institution. Fourth, continuing to challenge the institution at every level. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, to be fearless, to be not afraid. The possibility of decolonization as women, as Catholics, suggests the discomfort of living in a liminal space, an in-between state on the boundaries of existence that are not concrete, as Ann Patrick called it, an unfinished space. This certainly is an uneasy existence, but the comfort of a certain identity as women can lead to complacency, an acceptance of things as they are, the status quo, and a lack of questioning of critical perspective that brings about change. So I propose that the discomfort or uneasiness of being unfinished is a desirable place because it is a catalyst for creativity. It highlights the contradictions of our reality rather than status quo acceptance, and it challenges the existing reality by asserting a critical perspective. This is our decolonial challenge as Catholic women. Thank you.
So as we proceed tonight, I'm just going to, again, introduce each speaker before they go. And that's not meant to just pass on to the next one, but rather to hear these contributions from each of our panelists. And then, right, as we're going along, making those connections in your minds, observing what's happening in our ongoing painting, and seeing what it's drawing out in you. So our next panelist is Lynn Henke. Lynn is a senior in the College of Arts and Sciences at Georgetown University, studying theology and religious studies. On campus, she has been involved with Georgetown Green, retreat leadership, and Protestant ministry. In 2022, she received the Kalorama Fellowship to pursue her research on the connection between farming and spiritual experience. After graduation, she is headed to Princeton Theological Seminary as a Master Divinity candidate. Welcome, Lynn.
Thank you so much for having me here and for that introduction. Like she said, I'm Lynn. I'm a senior studying theology and religious studies here at Georgetown. And over my past 4 years here, I have discerned that I have a calling to ministry. I truly love studying theology. Wrestling with texts in my classes is one of the ways that I come into contact with the divine. But seeing myself as a minister was a different matter entirely. And I don't think it would have happened without Reverend Ebony Grissom, one of the Protestant chaplains here at Georgetown. Yes, snaps to Rev G. Early into my first year at Georgetown, I got to see Rev G preach for the first time. And until that moment, I honestly didn't think that I could preach. I didn't know that women of color especially, could preach without compromising their femininity. This is such a silly thing, but Rev G always wears really beautiful shoes under her robes. And when I saw that, I thought maybe I could do it too. Last night at Sunday night worship, right next door in Sister Thea Bowman, I preached a sermon for the first time. I did what seemed truly unthinkable to me 4 years ago, and got behind that pulpit. Next year, I'm headed to PTS for my Master's in Divinity, and I'm going to be a minister. I'm so grateful to the women that have paved the way for me, for Rev G, for Dr. Selak teaching me about feminist theology, for the amazing women on the panel, some of whose work I got to read in feminist theology, It's such an honor to meet my heroes in person and to be up here with all of you. Representation matters in all careers, but I think the theological stakes are very high here. Because when I was younger, the reason I thought I couldn't be a minister was intimately connected to my image of God. And I thought that certain attributes about myself meant that I was not compatible with the symbol of God. So when I thought that my voice was too high, or I wore too much pink, or that no one would ever see me as anything but a silly little girl, I was implicitly using the symbol of the conquering male God to undermine my very self. I couldn't see my embodied experience in the image of God. Anne E. Patrick, the brilliant thinker we're discussing today, said that the symbol of God functions either to oppress or liberate. And those are the theological stakes here. So I'm not here to argue that women should be included in ministry because they're good at this or that, because that argument says that women must perform in a certain way in order to be ministers and relies on inaccurate views about what it essentially means to be a woman. Instead, I think the argument goes something like this. Women are people, and all people, regardless of gender, are made in the image of God. So I don't want to expand the boundaries of ministry to let in a select few. Women that feel like safe choices, women that can tone down their femininity and perform whiteness, able-bodiedness, enough to match that old ingrained version of Imago Dei. It's not enough to say that women could resemble God as long as they keep certain parts of themselves toned down. I want to eradicate those boundaries for good, those lies that tell us that some bodies are better than others, that keep us divided, and nowadays, that keep young people from staying in the church. Annie Patrick says, and I wholeheartedly agree, that most basically I am oppressed when someone else tries to play God over me by defining the meaning of my life without respect for the mystery that is essential to my human personhood. And this oppression becomes set in concrete when I internalize the oppressor's assessment of my purpose and worth. We cannot let our purpose and worth be defined by a narrow and inaccurate view of God. God, who is boundless and knows each of us so intimately from the inside out. So I will not accept any sort of grudging expansion of the vocation of ministry. Annie Patrick and a long line of women before me are right. It's time to let go of the deeply idolatrous idea that God is male, because God is all of us. Thank you all.
It's a rare gift as an educator to be able to see one of your students on a panel and learn theology from them, right? So thank you, Lynn. Our next panelist is Alice McDermott. Author Alice McDermott's 8 novels have been finalists for the Pulitzer Prize, the National Book Award, the Penn Faulkner Award, and the National Book Critics Circle Award. Her novel, Charming Billy, won the National Book Award for Fiction. Her upcoming novel, Absolution, will be published in November by Farrar, Strauss, and Giroux. She studied English at SUNY Oswego and received her Master's of Arts from the University of New Hampshire. Welcome, Alice.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Annie, and thank you both of you for, I want to come hear you preach. It's a great pleasure. Thank you, especially to Jane. Great pleasure to be here and to see that so many of you here, because this is so important. Not being a theologian or a historian or an academic, an illegitimate academic, because I get to sneak in into the university by being a writer, I thought I would take a somewhat personal approach to this question. The Otto Preminger film, The Cardinal, was released in 1963 when I was 10 years old. So I guess it was some years later that it appeared on TV. I recall watching it with my mother. I watched a lot of movies with my mother. Early on, there's a scene where a young priest tells his pregnant sister's doctors that they must let her die in order to save her unborn child. I recall turning to my mother in disbelief. Would that really happen? Oh, yes, my mother assured me placidly enough, that's the rule in the Catholic Church. The baby's life comes first. I was at the age when the deaths of my parents, my dear mother especially, seemed an impossibility, something I would never be able to live through. Until then, I wanted my mother to have another baby. I was the youngest of three and the only girl. I wanted a sister. But after seeing the cardinal, I prayed she wouldn't get pregnant. I suppose I was still too young to imagine that the pregnant sister in the movie, the one who must die, could be me. My first encounter then with the diminished value my church assigns to women's lives. Not the last, of course. I recommend to you a book called The Turning Point by Robert McGlory, the inside story of the Papal Birth Control Commission of the early 60s. The commission, which included married Catholic couples, found an overwhelming desire among faithful married Catholic couples to be able to use birth control for the good of their marriages, but also overwhelmingly for the health of the women in the marriage, too many of whom knew the toll of multiple pregnancies or miscarriages or husbands who must be denied. Pleas that centered on the health of Catholic women. Well, we all know how that turned out. In the early part of this century, I had dinner in Boston with a small group of Catholic school teachers, all women, some nuns. The abuse scandal had just broken, and their collective cry was one of opportunity missed. They could have protected these children from priestly predators, they said, if only the male hierarchy had told them which priests to look out for. If the male hierarchy had shared what they knew about these troubled men, these women were certain they could have run interference whenever a suspected priest called a child out of their classrooms. These women didn't want to change the male hierarchy or the power structure in the church. They didn't even wish to see the scandal exposed. They simply wished the cardinal and the other male pastors had trusted them, confided in them, enlisted their help for the good of the children. They wished they had been treated as equals, worthy of full participation in the life of the church, even in its failings. Over the course of my adulthood, I have watched our church abandon the complex moral discussion that pertains to women's reproductive health in exchange for a simplistic legal solution: overturn Roe. I've seen the leadership of the church reject the challenge to convince, to counsel, to discern, to preach in favor of promoting secular laws that will only coerce. Even, by the way, as Catholic men who choose to take up arms in order to destroy innocent lives in war are told, each to his own conscience, to his own understanding of just war, of morally acceptable self-defense, of justifiable murder. I suppose all these matters were on my mind the first Sunday I went to Mass after the Dobbs decision. I was aware, of course, that, as a Catholic woman friend told me, the institutional church would be doing a victory lap. But I was not aware of how my soul would recoil. There's no other word. When the priest, a man I know to be a good priest, appeared on the altar. I love the Mass. I love the Eucharist. For all the anguish my church has caused in the world and in my own heart, I have never been denied the peace and understanding and renewal of hope and love that the Mass has always afforded me. But on this day, I saw my presence in my own church as a kind of collusion. A collusion with misogyny, with hypocrisy, with the conviction that to be female is to be the other, to be the lesser, less complex, less moral, less valuable, less worthy. As Catholics, we are well aware of, we celebrate the outward signs of inner grace. Our rituals are built on the importance of those signs and symbols. Our church, our spirits thrive on them as a source of good. But if there are outward signs of inner grace, then surely there are outward signs of inner corruption as well. Outward signs that betray our faults, our sinfulness, and our failures. It grieves me to say that the all-male priesthood of the Catholic Church, my church, has become for me just such a sign.
Thank you for that reflection, Alice, and sharing your experience. As we move through the panel, one thing that I do want to underscore is we're all approaching these topics from our own experiences, right? Which is very much a part of feminist theology of grounding an experience. And that we also are not attempting to present to you, the six of us together, a cohesive plan, right? But here are our very real, deeply rooted experiences of love, of joy, of hope, of pain, right? And we're part of the way that we designed this panel was to address this from so many different parts as well, which even three people in, I think we're I am getting that sense. And so as we move to our last two panelists, I hope we do so in that spirit as well. So our next panelist is Angèle White. Angèle Cabrini-White is the founder and chairperson of the Black and Women's History Ministry at St. Martin of Tours Catholic Church in Washington, D.C. She received her certification from Wesley Theological Seminary to serve as a health minister, infusing her love for community outreach and empowerment with a strong sense of spirituality. A native of New Orleans, she studied microbiology at Xavier University of Louisiana and received two masters in public health from Tulane University. Her commitments to equity, health, and social justice informs her DMV community, parish, and professional work at Georgetown University. Welcome, Angèle.
Good evening. My name is Angèle Cabrini Marie White. I was born and raised in New Orleans, Louisiana, still considered one of the top cities with the largest percentage of Catholics in the United States. Old stats show that New Orleans has about 36% versus the District of Columbia, which has 23%, 11% for Baltimore, and 8% for the entire state of Virginia. I've lived in D.C., in the D.C. area for 24 years, and have been a member of St. Martin of Tours Catholic Church for almost 20. So I believe that I'm no longer considered a transplant in the DMV. Coming from a city seeped in history to another city that's the cornerstone of the nation, I've been able to embrace a love for history, not just the facts that occurred near or in the spaces where I lived. People are living history. They are from a variety of cultures and from different quadrants. From the district to wards 9 and 10 in Maryland, there's really no 9 and 10. And from the outreaches of Nova to BMO, Baltimore, Silver Spring, St. Mary's, and the shores of St. Michael's, I believe people are living history, just like we are all spiritual beings living a natural experience. As mentioned, I am the founder of the founder and member of the Black and Women's History Ministry, started at St. Martin of Tours Catholic Church in Washington, D.C. B&W, as it's often called, started out of an interest to extend a tradition set forth by other resilient Catholic women before me at St. Martin's and other positive Catholic women who have made their mark in my personal life. Ask me later and I'll tell you about my top five. I'm not a historian, but tonight I want to share information about the history of Catholics in the United States and its relationship to the history of women and Black people. Historically, Catholics have suffered discrimination. The first Catholic settlers, English gentlemen, some with families, a few artisans, laborers and indentured servants, and a Jesuit priest, arrived to America in around 1634. In fact, Father Andrew White and 200 colonists celebrated the first Mass in the English New World on St. Clement's Island on the Potomac River on March 25th, 1634. It was also this group of new Americans who passed the first law for religious freedom, the 1649 Act of Toleration. It wasn't until decades later when the English hierarchy, with strong influences on their colonial counterparts here in America, decided to not only move the capital of Maryland from the predominant Catholic city of St. Michael's to Annapolis, but enact a series of discriminatory laws against Catholics. Catholics were barred from voting, practicing law, and holding public office. They were forbidden to worship in churches they practiced in homes or tents, or to make converts to the faith. In fact, Catholic landowners were required to pay double taxes. So these are just a few of the historical discriminatory laws against Catholics in America. Unfortunately, if I were to take the facts regarding those discriminatory acts and others and replace the words Catholic with women or Black people, the same pattern would apply to those individual groups. As we know, just because a law has been passed doesn't mean it is a law that everyone follows. Although slavery was abolished in 1865, it was not until after the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, whereby civil, political, and legal rights and protections to African Americans, including the former enslaved and their descendants, was officially mandated to end segregation in public and private facilities. Moreover, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibits the discrimination on the basis of sex, race, color, religion, or national origin in public places. Title IX, an amendment of the Higher Education Act of 1965, became official 7 years later in 1972, was established so that no person based on their sex would be discriminated against under any educational program or activity receiving federal money. And it was not until 1974 when the Equal Credit Opportunity Act prohibited discrimination against credit applicants based on their gender, race, religion, or national origin. Now, I mentioned that idea of single women not being able to have credit cards to a group of girls in my Sunday school class at St. Martin's. And their eyes widened over their masks in dismay, saying, "That's not right at all." So why do I mention all of these historical facts? And what do they have to do with women being allowed to go through the process of ordination? Because change takes time. It takes determination. It takes strategy. It takes risks. It takes patience. And it takes compassion and passion. Change takes learning from mistakes and working towards better. It does not mean settling for something that's unjust. It does not mean seeking equal. It means gaining equity. It's not that we as women want to be accepted. It is that many men in the leadership are not receptive. It's not that women don't already lead in the church. It's just that many men prefer the club of men in leadership. And yes, I understand the feeling of, well, if you don't like it, lump it or leave. But we all know if that were truly the case, there would probably be no women in positions of power to make meaningful changes, with the exception of ladylike, wifely, or motherly duties designated by men. And there would be no Black Catholics in the church or in any facets of society, possibly. Just like women not allowed to be priests, can you believe that in the new millennium there are still no African-American Catholic saints? So tonight, let's pray for peace. Let's pray for our leaders in power. Let's pray for African-Americans to achieve official sainthood. And let's pray for equity in the election and selection of all people of good heart and spirit called to serve the church in love, truth, justice, and priesthood. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Our final panelist tonight is Mary Hunt. Mary E. Hunt is a feminist theologian who is co-founder and co-director of the Women's Alliance for Theology, Ethics, and Ritual, or called WATER, in Silver Spring, Maryland, United States, what I think is the best acronym in theology. A Catholic active in the women church movement and on LGBTQI+ matters, she lectures and writes on theology and ethics with particular attention to liberation issues. She received her Ph.D. from the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley, California. She received a Master's in Divinity from the Jesuit School of Theology at Berkeley and a Master's in Theological Studies from Harvard Divinity School. Her undergraduate degree is in theology and philosophy from Marquette University. Welcome, Mary.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening and happy Emancipation Day here in Washington. Thank you for inviting me to be on this wonderful panel and to be part of this lovely group of women. If the non-ordination of Catholic women has produced anything good, it's our collective ability to see many ways to be church, many ways to minister. Living creatively with our different Catholic approaches, we model what a mature community looks like when the crying needs of the world, not the failings of the institutional church, set the priorities. Hearty thanks to Jane and to Annie for your careful curation of this event and to the sponsors and staffs involved. I look forward to Celeste's art. I can't see it from here, but I'm greatly looking forward to it. I begin with a deep bow to Anne E. Patrick of blessed memory, whose essay is our springboard tonight. She published it 6 months before the inaugural Women's Ordination Conference meeting in Detroit in November of 1975, which she helped to organize. She was prescient and practical, reminding women's ordination opponents that they were rejecting a move that would reinforce and reinscribe their favored conservative model of church. So little progress has been made on the ecclesial front on this question that, alas, her wonderful essay remains fresh and useful today. So much progress has been made by Catholic women that the very question of ordination has changed from ordaining women to ordaining anyone. I was a graduate student when I attended that 1975 conference where I met some of the pioneers in this work, including the great ethicist Margaret Farley, who insisted on women's ordination as a moral imperative. I lectured at the next women's ordination conference in Baltimore in 1978 on reshaping priestly ministry for everyone. I added a Master of Divinity degree at the Jesuit School of Theology to my theological studies. Priestly preparation included clinical pastoral education for me, where I worked as a prison chaplain. It also included training in preaching and sacraments along with everything else. I learned there that priesthood as currently conceived was inadequate to the needs of those whom priests serve and constraining of those who are ordained. The model of top-down, clerical, caste-led church with no shared decision-making simply does not work. That was only 45 years ago. Since then, I have seen few, if any, substantive structural changes in Roman Catholicism. Catholic women are another story. What began as a largely US Western European movement now has women leaders from around the world. Women and other lay people do much more preaching, accompanying, and teaching, as well as tending the needy, but without access to decision making and with continued prohibitions on sacramental work. Many women function as deacons, a role which scholar Phyllis Zagano claims is not inexorably linked to the priesthood. But these women are not recognized as deacons. Many women, including some nuns, have left the institutional church in favor of small-based communities that seem to do just fine on their own. They've left for other denominations, and some of them have done none of the above. The late Canadian Jesuit theologian Bernard Lonergan was right when he observed that concepts have dates. If the moral imperative to ordain women had been fulfilled in the 1970s, Catholicism would be very different today. The ordination of women would not necessarily have prevented criminal clergy sexual misconduct, nor would it have educated people about the many sexual orientations and gender identities among us. Nor perhaps would it even have deepened our collective commitment to eradicate poverty and war, to heal Earth, and to bring about global peace. But not ordaining women, the non-ordination of women, decades after the case was made for it theologically, scripturally, and pastorally, has left the institutional Roman Catholic Church in an intellectually and morally untenable position without much credibility to announce any good news. The loss of the enormous talent and generosity of women and non-binary persons wishing to engage in Catholic sacramental ministries has diminished the quality and quantity of ministry for all. The question today, in my view, is not about ordaining women. Most Christian and Jewish denominations do that already. 50 years later, the key question is why ordain anyone, and for what, and for how long? A related issue is whether jurisdiction or decision-making should be linked to presbyteral ordination. Why do pastors and bishops get to decide about money, personnel, use of buildings, and curricula? The failure to meet the question of women in its time, Bernard Lonergan's concepts have dates, is ironic. In the 80s and 90s, we thought we knew what a woman was. We thought we knew what a man was. Ideas that are not crystal clear these days, because our understanding of gender happily has expanded. Today, we need a wholesale rethinking of ordination, both in relation to jurisdiction and as it relates to the needs of immigrants, refugees, those who are sick and dying, and especially those who are oppressed by racism, reproductive injustice, and greed. why turn away women and non-binary persons who wish to make such work their vocations? One bright spot is that we already have women who are Catholic priests. Women are ordained in the old Catholic Church. They're ordained through Roman Catholic women priests, the Association of Roman Catholic Women Priests, and in small-based communities around the world, despite some of them being excommunicated by the institutional Roman Catholic Church. And Catholic women are ordained in many other Christian denominations, and they are no less Catholic because of it. Some trans people are ordained. Trans women who are ordained when they identified as men are still priests, according to the traditional Catholic theology. And one can assume that there are trans persons who began their earthly journeys as women who are now clerics. These are new realities that religious communities and dioceses are beginning to recognize. They render the women's ordination question tame and dated at best. If we ordain anyone, its qualifications, education, training, aptitude, gifts for ministry, and communal call that is so important and will become obvious among all of us, women, non-binary persons, as well as men, celibate as well as sexually active persons, queer and straight. The issue is who decides. How do communities set standards so leaders best meet the needs of the members? How is jurisdiction or decision-making shared when ordained people have no more right or reason to make decisions about finances or who receives sacraments than anyone else? These, I think, are today's questions. If the needs of the world, not the failings of the church, set the agenda. Let me repeat, when the needs of the world, not the failings of the church, set the agenda. If we as Catholics are to feed the hungry, house the unhoused, and work to overturn structures of oppression, it makes no sense to squander more time and talent by excluding whole categories of people from ministry. Communities, not clerics, celebrate Eucharist. Compassionate people and a compassionate God, not priests, forgive sins. How can we share the power? Yes, women and non-binary people want power to minister. Power to minister. How can we share the resources of the institutional church that belong to all of us so that the works of mercy and the gospel imperative to do justice are met in the 21st century? I'm all in on these questions and the theological work necessary to bring them to fruition. Thank you so much, and I look forward to our continued conversation.
Thank you. So now I'll offer a few questions to our panelists, and then after that, we'll open it up to the audience. And for our panelists, you know, I'll pose a question. We can go in whatever order speaks to you. Not everyone has to answer everything, right? But I'm mindful of, as I look down the row and see our panelists, right, throughout this conversation, there have been moments of joy, there have been moments of laughter, there's been big questions asked, and I think there's also been moments of pain too, right? And I want to start with that experience of pain. So the exclusion of all genders except for cisgender men from the priesthood in the Roman Catholic Church can be incredibly painful. And this pain is felt acutely by those who cannot respond to the God's call to express their ministry. But it's also painful for all in the church who cannot experience this ministry. So my question to you all is, how do you respond to this pain? Have you found any balms to this pain?
I'll attempt a response here, Annie. And what comes to mind is something that was shared with me by a woman religious, sister of charity, who worked with Catholic organization, and I asked her as we were talking about issues of women's ordination, a long-standing relationship, and I was teaching at Iona, and I asked her, you know, in the midst of the clergy, sex abuse, horrors that were unfolding, I asked her, where do you find your hope in the midst of all this pain? How do you maintain your faith? And she said, and this made me very sad, she said, I find that I'm able to keep my faith as long as I don't enter into a church. And that, coming from her, was very striking to me. And over time, I've understood that. Now, that doesn't mean, that she didn't pray, she didn't have community, but entering into that institutional space was a painful encounter, a traumatic encounter, and that she had made a choice not to continue to traumatize herself that way. And I found that to be both hopeful and painful at the same time.
For sharing that. The first thing I thought of when you said that was how difficult it is to face pain alone and how monumental it can seem when you're facing it alone. And I couldn't help but think of my best friend Savannah, who I've been talking to since first year about how hard it is sometimes, how hard it is to be a woman in the church and the pain that we go through. And I have so many wonderful friends and mentors, and we have to have these conversations together, or I wouldn't be here, I wouldn't have the strength to go forward and to put myself in this position. So I think that when I think about a balm for pain, I think of my community and my friends, and how we kind of pass it around and we lift each other up.
I'm reminded some years ago, a friend of mine, also DNA Catholic, talking about our chagrin. I don't think we called it pain, but just how difficult it was and how many things you rolled your eyes over if you participated in the institutional church. And she said she began to think of it as that lovable old uncle who you've loved since you were born, and you know he has the best heart, and you know how he loves you. And he's the one you go to when you have to sort things out, and he's the one who slips you extra money when you need it before you go out. But he's also the one who every once in a while will say something incredibly racist or incredibly stupid. Or embarrassing to your friends. And she said, that's how I think of my church. Mm-hmm. I love it. I understand it has a good heart. But just like those old uncles, he was raised in a different time and place, and you just have to roll your eyes and continually forgive him if you're going to benefit from his presence and that big heart, you know, that's there. At the time in that conversation, I thought, I understand that. I don't understand that anymore. my tolerance for that old uncle, it's time for the old uncle to stop with the racist and the inappropriate comments, because I love that uncle and I recognize his good heart. I also believe that he can change. It's a convoluted metaphor, I'm sorry.
What came to mind for me was a memory during as a child. My mother is Catholic, my father is Baptist. And something happened at school, went to a Catholic school, of course, and I came home crying because something that the pastors, the priest said or didn't say, or I can't even remember what it was, but what stuck with me, it was what my mother said, which was, Angel, you're not going to school, to a Catholic school, for a man. You're going to Catholic school to learn about God and how Christianity plays a role in your life. And so with lots of different issues that come through the church, I think that's the starting point for me. It's like, okay, it's not about this man, it's not about this person situation, because you're not you're really not here for that. Like I said before, we're not natural beings having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings who are living a natural experience. And so just trying to reiterate that.
Thank you. Yeah, I find the question of pain problematic in the sense that while there's a lot of pain, and I don't trivialize any of it at all, as a white woman of certain resources and education and so forth, I would be loath to make my pain somehow the center of things. I think the way you phrased the question was so helpful, because what you said is it's the whole community that suffers, not just as individuals. And I guess if there's anything that I think is hard, it's that it's not the failings of the institutional church, which are legion, but the extent to which it could be so much more, and it could be a force for something so much greater in a world which needs every bit of help in terms of our racist, bellicose, sexist greedy way of living. And I think the message that could be coming, which can't be heard and will not be heard and will not be preached, with all due respect, by people who don't live it, should not be preached by people who don't live it, it becomes a countersign. And I think this really is a problem that we now have lived into, being this countersign. I think, Alice, you made a good case for it, but it's a countersign now. And it's not just embarrassing. It is embarrassing, but it's not just embarrassing. It's a tragedy because of what it could be and how privilege is squandered. And so as a person of relative privilege, I'm not going to go there, but to say how much fun I've had in the last 50 years working on these issues. To be well accompanied, for example, by the Women's Ordination Conference, Kate McElwee's here tonight, and people who work with Catholics for Choice, and people who work with Dignity, and the Rainbow Network of Rainbow Catholics, Global Network of Rainbow Catholics. I mean, there's such a tremendous amount of work being done. Las Hermanas in its day, the Black Sisters, so many women's groups and others doing this work that we also have a blast. I mean, I have to say, I don't mean to be Pollyannish about it. I've had more laughs and more fun and felt more the authenticity of what the message of the gospel might be in those groups that I can't complain.
Thank you.
Different way of looking at it, but.
Another thing that I was thinking, and right, I'm an ecclesiologist, so of course I'm going to approach this from a question of, like, who is the church? What is the church? How do we understand church? But the church, broadly understood, is an evolving entity. So, yes, we are steeped in tradition, and as St. Bede the Venerable said, every day the church gives birth to the church. So, and we're also gathered tonight under this name of faith, feminism, and being unfinished. And it's that unfinished notion, right? We've heard it in so many remarks of visions of tapestry and weaving, what that looks like. I'm curious, right? Many of us have written long books on what is unfinished in the church and what the church could be. And we're rooted in that vision, Mary, that you said of, like, looking at really what the church is truly called to be and what it could be. But I'm curious, what would be like your number one priority or your number one unfinished item for the church? Again, church broadly understood. And we can go in whatever order you'd like.
We'll go the other way. My number one priority is structural change. Structural change, Teresa, you said it as well, structural change. And I long ago came up with an idea of the move from a pyramid, which we know so well, to a pinwheel. And that if the church were more like a pinwheel, where there was some organizing center, which I think is the message of the gospel, and something that anchors it, which I think is the spirit, and then those equidistant elements of a pinwheel, which when you get just enough breath in it, they're different, but they're equidistant, they're seen as, they mirror equity. That's where I think the structural change would take place, and that so much could come from that on a variety of issues. I'll leave it at that. My friend?
Yes. I would say taking, and I'm paraphrasing the quote, but you know, those who ignore history are doomed to repeat it. Mm-hmm. And it seems like we just, in some cases, are just continually going through that vicious cycle. And that's where our group looks at history in the past and things that were done, how they're impacting our present, looking at issues that are going on now and how we can see them and take action towards making a better future. So using that as a tool throughout all facets of the church. We have a lot of history in the Catholic Church. And taking that time to really seeing all those facets. I think I was in high school, Catholic high school. Actually, I went to Cabrini Elementary, Cabrini High School, middle name Cabrini. I was astonished when, you know, the nun said that, when she made a comment saying that, oh, well, what do you think if all of these story, these messages in the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, are just stories? It's like, it's the Bible, sister. What are you talking about? Just stories. And the idea that, they could be based in fact, but the premise behind that is your guide for how you are to live. And seeing that from that perspective, not that every, because of course, as you know, you can pick different things out of the Bible and make it say whatever you want it to say. But really understanding that history that's there and seeing how we can make a difference with even some of the social and political things that are going on now to all people in our church.
Oh my goodness. Other than a long laundry list that sounds like changing the entire structure of the institutional church, which is not a bad idea at all. We could start there. I suppose, especially of late, my ambitions are maybe more language related. It seems to me when I read the New Testament, hypocrisy is the word that Jesus used quite often. And if we could have a synod in the Catholic Church focused on hypocrisy, that might be a place where we could slowly begin to change the structure of the church, because there is so much hypocrisy in the structure itself, in the public pronouncements of the church, in the all-male clergy, in the humble servants of the Lord who wear big golden hats and carry big golden shepherd staffs as they walk past the people to the altar. They're trailing hypocrisy in that moment. So maybe rather than just let's listen to each other, which is a lovely thing to do. And synod is a great new word. took me a couple of months to know it wasn't Senate. but maybe a universal synod on hypocrisy, looking at the words of Jesus, because he liked that word.
Like a lot of young people, I think the climate crisis is pretty much always at the front of my mind, and I think that it's probably the greatest challenge that all of us, including the church, are going to have to face in the next 50 years. And I'm not Catholic, but I'm always really impressed with the work that the Catholic Church is doing in terms of environmental justice. There are so many amazing small land-based environmental justice movements happening in Asia, happening in South America, that are coming out of the Catholic Church. And I would love to see so much more of that, so much more environmental justice solidarity going forward.
It's really hard to be the last one after all of that. But what I would add is that I'm going to go back to the word decolonization, because I think that that word itself has a lot of currency these days and gets used a lot, and yet the ways in which that can be actualized for institutions is very it has less currency in that regard. And I think we need to, as Catholics, pay more attention to not just saying or, you know, putting out a statement repudiating a doctrine of discovery, but then taking that the step further to say, well, what have been the effects of the way that doctrine has been used? And then how can we offer some reparation for that abuse, misuse, and complete, I would say, distortion of the gospel, distorting the gospel in such a way as to use it to completely oppress other peoples. And that's very personal to me because, you know, as a Puerto Rican woman, colonization is central in my mind, and I just can't imagine. It's hard for me to imagine a world where we're truly decolonized. But I firmly believe that that's a path that we really have to take seriously. In every way that we can, including our church structures.
Angela? Yeah, I just wanted to say when you said a word, that's so very important. I know during COVID, a lot of people would say, well, where's your faith? You know, faith is in the Bible 5,000 and whatever times. And I said, and how many times is the word fool there? Fool is in the Bible a lot of times, said by Jesus. So, but that key, the word hypocrisy is a very good word for them to set that structural change on. And that same nun, was the one who gave us our history lesson that one of the key reasons men, priests, weren't, they asked them not to marry was because the church decided, oh, well, if they marry, then where does the land go? You know, when that priest dies, it's going to go to the wife and it's going to go to the children. So if they don't get married... maybe we get to keep that land.
Yes.
So just kind of having that, and that was the first time, like I said, high school, that somebody even brought that up. So just the idea of once again, infusing the history and the words are power.
Thank you. I do want to be able to open it up for questions from the audience. So for a few guidelines for how to do that, Sophia and Jada are two of our students who have microphones and will travel to you, so you can go ahead and raise your hand. But here's how I want us to structure our time together. So one is that these are questions, right? If you have wonderful, I'm sure all of you have reactions and thoughts, and the reception afterwards is a great place to share that with others, not this question and answer time. So please form your question as a question for our panel. We also like to give priority to students, right? So our community here is very diverse, and Georgetown is a place of education. So for students here, we'll go ahead and start with your questions, and then we can move to other community members.
Hi there, my name is Bakita. I'm currently a senior in the School of Foreign Service here, and I just wanted to thank you so much for your insightful perspective. And really, I just wanted to stand with you in solidarity against, you know, the violence, abuse, and discrimination that has been part of, you know, the church's unfortunate history. And I, as a Catholic myself, have been really trying to grapple with these issues. I actually just came back from a trip from Rome over Holy Week, and I have just been really experiencing how much, although the institution has had its problems, that a lot of why we are still Catholic and why the church still stands is through the martyrdom and the fierceness of a lot of the people, scholars, popes, and theologians, and faithful Catholics like yourselves. And many lives were lost over certain doctrinal decisions, you know. Even the creed that we recite at every Mass, you know, we have fought many battles over that. And so I was interested to know, there are some fundamental truths that as Catholics we hold to be tenets of the faith, like, you know, the belief that Jesus is in the Eucharist every time we receive him. However, only 30% of Americans believe in the doctrine of transubstantiation. And so if we are to change church teaching based on the beliefs of the majority, should we change other doctrines? And how, as students or as women, should we search for the truth whilst holding to the specific tenets of our Catholic faith, which in some ways does mandate that certain doctrinal truths don't change based on popular opinion? And then I also wanted to have some advice or some insight into what the church's authority is to decide on this decision. Many Catholic theologians and popes, including Pope Francis and St. John Paul II, have stated that the church has no authority to confer priestly ordination on women, simply because it's modeled after the decision that Christ made when he appointed his apostles. At the same time, I really do believe, as a woman myself, that we do play an extremely important role in ministry and in the church, as many female saints are. I'm named after St. Bakita. She's someone who is very much close to me. And Mary, the Mother of God, whose role has shaped the church importantly, without taking the role of ministerial priesthood. And so I'd be really curious to know, first of all, how to navigate this discussion on changing church doctrine, and second of all, what the church's authority is on this matter. Thank you.
So for the questions from the audience, we'll just open it up and whoever would like to respond. And I'll also say for our panelists, right, there may be one part of the question that stands out to you or things like that. So feel free to respond to a part, right? All of this work is unfinished. So looking at that, if we can't address all aspects.
Where to begin?
This seems like a question for the theologian.
Well, I'll take the last. Thank you for your question, and I hope you had a nice time in Rome. It's a beautiful city. The one part of your question that I'll take is the question of what is the basis of the non-ordination of women? What's the latest church teaching on that? And it is important, I think, to be clear on where that comes from. And there really are two aspects to it. One is, as the church teaches, one is that there were no women at the Last Supper. And no video, but that's That is literally the teaching of the church, that there were no women at the Last Supper. And the second reason against the ordination of women, I don't do comedy, but the second issue is really, and this is, we could find this for you in terms of the text, but the second issue is really the question of the so-called natural resemblance, that women do not bear a natural resemblance to Jesus in the Eucharist. And this raises the question of what we really mean by a natural resemblance, and I'll leave that to your imagination. But that, those are the two, and I mean this sincerely, those are the two most recent reasons given against the ordination of women. And what I want to suggest is that they're based on what I would refer to as a kind of biologistic worldview rather than a symbolic worldview, which is what we live out of. We live out of a symbolic worldview. And that has to do with the question, too, of authority. Who has authority to decide what is the worldview? And worldviews change and doctrines change and churches change and people change. And so the question is, how does that process work? But those, just take that as an example, and I think you can see how much there is to remediate, as it were, in this understanding, and how easy it will be once people begin to do theology out of a very different worldview of symbol rather than biology, to begin to understand the range of human experiences and the range of ways in which people can engage in priestly ministry. But that's the honest answer of, and Teresa will bear me out. I wish it weren't, you know what I mean? It's right. Kind of embarrassing to have to say it.
But. And I would also add to that, again, thank you for your question, because it's something that I've thought about a lot. I guess I wonder, because you asked the question about, do we kind of just go with the whims of societal change? Right, and what stays true? And I would argue that perhaps the more voices, the more diverse voices that we have in this question, in the conversation, allows us to find that truth more clearly in a way that has been obscured in the past, because there have been so few and so limited a number of those in authority who've been able to interrogate the question. What would it mean then? I mean, we clearly see that the adding more voices to that very question about where is the truth will lead to different kinds of answers. And I would say, why be afraid of that? Why be afraid of the possibility that somehow what we have known to be true may not have been? And we need to see truth with a broader lens. So I'm thinking that's the moment we're in right now. And perhaps there are some who don't want to engage in that questioning because it will crumble the truth that they've known. And I think that's, where I said before, be not afraid. That's where we have to live into these kinds of questions with fearlessness.
I think that response actually leads in very well to a question from some of our virtual audience. And this question is from Sue. They say, given that throughout history, those in power seem to never share power they have without being forced, how do you think that change will ever come to the Catholic Church regarding seeing women as fully equal? And I might expand that, right? We have also talked about looking at a diversity of genders in ministry, looking at the expansion of ministry, but also an expansion of an understanding of the church.
I can only think of the unfortunately becoming hackneyed quote from Martin Luther King Jr. that the arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. I think as as human beings in centered in a loving community that is centered on the words of Christ, we have to believe it may be long, but that we are moving towards justice and truth slowly, but inevitably. We might not live to see it. the earth might not survive long enough for us to see it, but I think that sense that the fact that we're gathered here right now, and any times we gather and we are church, I think the underlying promise is that we are gathering in hopes of finding truth and justice and incorporating the voices that over time have been left out but are slowly being heard. Very slow. I have a very dear friend who's a Monsignor, almost 99 years old. 20 years ago, I said to him, how long before we have women priests in the Catholic Church? And he said, two popes. And then Benedict became pope. And he said, three popes. But we're a hopeful people. We wouldn't be here if we weren't.
Yeah, I think there's a lot too that we're already there. You know, that I mean, look at this panel. You know, think of this building 50 years ago. Did the panel look like this? And they were having heavy theological conversations, but the panel didn't look like this. And I mean that in many ways, both in terms of racial ethnic difference, both in terms of age, of starting points, of work that we do. I think women have brought enormous diversity, not just around gender, but around respecting the various ways in which we understand ourselves and understand ourselves as church, so that the person, the most important person isn't the bishop or the cardinal. The most important person is the person who's feeding the hungry. The most important person is the one who's working against war. The most important, I think, and we've also done it, and that's why I'm so delighted this panel is not all Catholic. We've done it in ecumenical and interreligious ways. And we've also found ways to respect the work of people who are not wishing to be religious anymore, and particularly aren't wishing to be religious in institutional ways. And I find those are all marvelous, and again, I'm not making a virtue of necessity, but I think they're marvelous advances that women are already living, and that the rest of the church is may, in some good time, catch up with it, may not. But in the meantime, that work of love and justice, which I think is at the heart of things, is being done by people who yes, are church. And that gives me great, I mean, otherwise I would, you know, put my head in a microwave oven after 50 years of this, you know. But I have enormous hope in what we're doing and enormous pride in what we have accomplished and what I think women of my college-age daughter's generation and yours and others is really, it's really exciting what they are able to do, what they think. My daughter was once asked what her parish was, and she mentioned the name of the church, but she said, I go to such and such food pantry, because she volunteers at the food pantry. Mm-hmm. And that was the name of her church. Mm-hmm. And that was a church building, that is a church building that has a tombstone out in front for the unborn. So you don't have to go into the church for many women mm-hmm. to have an experience of exclusion. It's mm-hmm. right outside. Mm-hmm. But my daughter was able to say that she belongs to the food pantry. I thought that was marvelous. That was marvelous.
Let's have time for maybe, please.
Yeah, so I was going to say, I just wanted to kind of echo mm-hmm. what has been said insofar as generational. I know that I had gone to church, the last service in the city at one time was right there in the Chinatown area. And I went to church, and I saw the priest wasn't talking to anyone. And they were, you know, using the sense, and I was like, okay, what's going on? And I said, oh, this is the Latin Mass. I'm like, oh, even though I'm from New Orleans, I'd never attended one, never really chose to attend one. So the idea that the priest was just talking to himself and everybody else was out there, that, you know, so the whole dynamic with Vatican I, Vatican II, where people, where I think people more so from my generation, especially in the younger generations, it's more of a discussion with say the priest or the person in charge. It's not so much begging or asking for permission. It's trying to have a discussion. Why can't I? Or why is this not insofar the sense of authority? It's a different viewpoint. It's like you tell someone, a Gen Z person, about a landline, and they're like, why would you put it in the land? So it's, I think that is something that is relevant.
We'll have time for one more question. Yes, right here. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. My name is Paige, and I'm a senior at Georgetown College, also studying theology. I may know one of the panelists. And I'm particularly passionate about the ordination of Orthodox Jewish women. And for better or worse, this is an interfaith fight. So while our struggles are definitely different and have different history and complexities, how do we contextualize the fight for recognized women's ordination in Christian and Catholic spaces in the midst of all the other interfaith work that's happening with ordination of women in different religious spaces?
I think, if I may, thank you for your question. And I think this is a continuation, I guess, of what you said earlier, Mary, which is that our interfaith dialogue is, and the interfaith solidarity among women is already happening. And to that extent, that is, there is power in that collective. I don't think we can really talk about the ordination of women and cisgendered men without having that as an interfaith conversation. You know, because it's already a dialogue that's happening, not just with Jewish women and Catholic women, but also Muslim women. And we need to continue to have that collective conversation, which again is already happening. So I guess it's an affirmation of the point that you've raised, and we can't have this as a kind of a singular, isolated, dialogue anymore. And I don't think it ever really was. Because I think at least from my understanding, the various waves of the women's movement have always been about pushing the boundaries and making that, more inclusive, learning about the blind spots. And to the credit of all the waves of the women's movement, there's been a recognition of of blind spots, and then an opening even further, and recognition of the blind spots, and opening even further. And I think that's still happening.
Yeah, one exciting thing is that the Jewish Orthodox Feminists of America, JOFA, are really doing great work. Blue Greenberg is one of the people, and we've worked with Blue Greenberg and her crowd over decades. And there are seminaries now. It's interesting, there are theological schools in certain parts of the country where students, kind of like in med school, all take the same first year courses together, Jewish students and Christian students, Catholic and Protestant. I'm not sure if Muslims are involved in it yet, but they all take the same classes in terms like an intro to ethics, an intro to church history, an intro to this, intro to that, and then they only specialize later. So they're beginning to do theological education. I congratulate both of you on your graduation this year. As theology majors, and think about that as an exciting thing to move into, where you might be sitting in your first year class with a Jewish student, someone from a totally different tradition. Mm-hmm. And then as you move on, specializing in your own area. But I think that's just a marvelous thing that's come along. So yes, it's from the very beginning, yeah. the inspiration of the Episcopal women who were ordained in 1975 was for Catholic women. It was like, well, it's just around the corner for us then. You know, that was a real thing. you can be so wrong. It's great. but it really was a thing, and it really did inspire Catholic women to go to seminary and to think that they would be ordained and to take seriously their own vocations and to study theology. But it was, and it had, those colleagues are still very close to many of us. Yeah. Just to take one example, there are lots of others.
And I would say that sometimes people in power don't want us to talk to each other. They don't want us to look past our own tradition to see what's happening in another tradition, or they'll even use women's oppression to put down another tradition. They'll say, oh, well, you're not oppressed. Look at this other tradition. Women are even more oppressed in that tradition, so that you won't look beyond the bounds of your own church and really start engaging in that interfaith dialogue, which can lead to interfaith activism. And I think Georgetown is doing a really great job with interfaith spaces and interfaith dialogue. I think it's one of the leading colleges in that, and I hope it will only continue to grow in that space. I've been really lucky this year to work an interfaith job, so I get to work Shabbat every week, work Buddhist meditation every week, and that's been really special just to like exist in those spaces and have those conversations, not as a one-time interfaith dialogue, oh, we're all gonna get together and it's a one-off thing, but to continually learn and grow in that space and connect with people, particularly women, in those space and realize some of our communal struggles.
Thank you.
I think it's about respect. I think women are, that whole like it or lump it thing, they're just not going for it. It's about respect. It's about respecting other faiths because, once again, we're all spiritual and can be gone tomorrow, this physical. Can be gone tomorrow. So that whole like it or lump it or leave, women are coming up with other ways of addressing those issues. And I'm glad that we have students like that here at Georgetown who are have that respect for themselves and women that have that respect for others.
I'm mindful of our time and how this conversation could go on, yet this work is unfinished. But as we close tonight, I invite us to turn our attention to the live art that Sister Celeste has been creating throughout our discussion tonight. And we recall the process that the Spirit is animating this art, reflecting the movements of our conversation. And I invite you to behold this art, to take a moment, and see what stands out to you. Is it reflective of your experience of this event? Does it draw out something new from tonight, something you hadn't previously noticed? This painting is a reminder that we are all always in process. There are few things that are fixed, but rather we are moving, hopefully, forward. And in this process, I invite you to consider how we all might be bold, as Sister Celeste's painting invokes. We gathered here tonight under the name Faith, Feminism, and Being Unfinished, The Question of Women's Ordination. And this work of art, all of us and our church, broadly understood, are unfinished. So as we go forward, my hope is for us gathered here on Georgetown's campus that we gather at White Gravener Tent for a reception, and we do so with a sense that this work is ongoing. That we are inherently unfinished, and the work of justice, especially justice in the church, is never complete. This is not something in which we should despair, but rather an invitation to engage in the work of justice. There is much to be done. And there is much hope that we can create a church where the gifts are all of all are embraced and celebrated. I'd also ask that you join together with me in thanking our panelists for their rich contributions to tonight. I think you all brought such an authentic, vulnerable part of yourself, and I thank you for that. I think that opened up that invitation for all of us gathered, both here in this room and throughout the world on Zoom. So thank you for that. Yes, Angel.
Just one last thing. I just would like to say one of my mother's sayings, and it was before it was even a saying, when she would want to challenge religious authority, she would say, "What would Mary do?" That's it. Which would do with a coin that early.
Thank you all for joining us. Thank you again to our panelists, and we go forth knowing that this work is unfinished, yet important, and we are all called to act. Thank you.
Thank you.